thank you once again for joining with me today on our Side by Side, as we are continuing to think about Romans and its very important but sometimes heavy teaching. I'm sure you've got one of those places in your home where you open the door and you look in and you think, oh no, I can't think to start that. It might simply be just a drawer in your kitchen full of all your bits and pieces. It might be a wardrobe where you just keep pushing the clothes in. It might be the hot press. It might be the garage. It might be a whole room in that case. And I'm sure you know what it's like. You just look at it and what happens is we feel overwhelmed. I think that's it. For me, sometimes it's looking at the garden, a bed in the garden, and the weeds are growing as they start to burst ahead of everything else. Or it's maybe cleaning the car or tidying the study, which I did for the first time thoroughly in 27 years in just recently at the end of January. I started at one end. I put everything I had in a box and I started to shred paper. I had bags and bags of paper shredded. I can hardly believe that you could stuff as much stuff into one small room. Now, I have it cleaned. I have it organized. I know that I begin with Genesis and I end with Revelation in my commentaries. I have my theology. I have my biographies. I have my apologetics as I look around this study. I've even got two shelves completely clean. Wow, how does that not make me feel when I come in the morning? There's space. Things are so much better. And you know, when you come to the Bible, I think sometimes we look at it the same way. We think there's so much here. Where do I begin? We feel overwhelmed. But then if we start at the door and work our way in, it's amazing how soon things take shape. Maybe you've had that experience that I've had. You know, what I thought was just an overwhelming impossibility, I started, and little by little, it started to clear. And before long, I said, wow, that's amazing. I've waited for years, and it really only took me a few days. Well, you know, Romans is one of those sections of the Bible that might feel like that to you. When you come to it, you say, oh, it's so full of things. I can't even, where do I begin? But you know, let's just begin in a simple way. And that's what I'm trying to do these weeks with us. I am not able to grasp the incredible depth of some of these subjects because they are so deep. They're beyond our own experience in some ways. So we have to start again today. So we're sort of just beginning at the door, we're picking up a few things and we're going to work our way in there. Now, have you ever played the game Let's Pretend? Well, I'm sure you have. Sometimes you played it as a child, your imagination's fired up. Maybe you were in the Wild West as a cowboy, or maybe you were an astronaut, or you were flying into space, or maybe you were a nurse. Well, for me it was I was a racer on a small bicycle with solid tires. Yes, can you imagine? Solid tires. Did you even know things existed in the 20th century? Well, I have no idea how anybody found that bike, but they got it. Well, I would ride it round and round our backyards for hours, overtaking the imaginary competitors and fighting all the way to a photo finish. Well, the things then get a bit more serious when we start pretending when we're older. Now, I'm no longer riding the small bike, but when I come to a section of scripture like Romans 6, I think I'm going to have to pretend a little bit, because is this really true, what I'm reading here? Let me read you just a few verses. We read here, and I'm reading from verse 3. Have you forgotten that when we were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism, we joined him in his death? For we died and were buried with Christ by baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we may live new lives. Do you know, you say, well, I died with Jesus. My baptism is a symbolic of being buried and then being raised up again with Jesus. Wow, that's a bit heavy, isn't it? What's that really all about? You see, in these passages, we are entering a world of the amazing and the supernatural. We're speaking now of things that seem far removed from our daily world. of how God brings about the deepest changes in our situation and how he enables us to find a path out of failure and the repetitive spiral downwards. Why anyone would struggle with this is not hard to see, especially if this is new to you. Do you know, even long-travel Christians will have skimmed at this at times because it's too heavy, they feel. But just think about those again. Verse 3. Have you forgotten that when we were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism, the symbol of baptism was pointing to a deep reality? For we died and were buried with Christ. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we may also live new lives. You see, the symbolism of the act of baptism in the early church was a clear picture of a reality. It pointed to something that had actually happened. Now, the fact that it happened, you may say, well, but have I experienced that? Well, yes and no. You were not physically there with Jesus, but you were there in the mind of Christ when he died. Christ died for you and I. Christ rose again, that he would then give you the power of his Holy Spirit who would indwell you and enable you to live this life. It means that we are now free from the power of sin. That's what it says in verses 18 and 22. It says we are free from the power of sin. Listen to what it says. Now you are free from your slavery to sin and you have become slaves to righteous living. Or again, verse 22. But now you are free from the power of sin and have become slaves to God. Now you do those things that lead to holiness and result in eternal life. You see, our union with Christ, that relationship that we have, is real, but it's invisible. And that's important to remember. We are often looking for the real. Give me the experience. Give me the feeling. The feeling does not make a thing real. I love a statement that C.S. Lewis says. He says this, "The presence of God is not the same as the sense of the presence of God. The latter may be due to imagination. The former may be attended with no sensible consolation at all. The act which engenders a child ought to be and usually is intended by pleasure. But it's not the pleasure that produces the child. Where there is pleasure, there may be sterility. Where there is no pleasure, the act may be fertile. And in the spiritual marriage of God and the soul, it's the same. It's the actual presence, not the sensation of the presence of the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit, which begets Christ in us. The sense of the presence is a super added gift for which we give thanks when it comes." Isn't that helpful? I find that helpful. It's a very physical picture, but it just helps us understand, I think. Maybe you want to go back and re-listen to this because we're talking of things that are indeed quite deep. You see, only those who believe can obey, and the path of holiness is truly a path of wholeness. Temptation addresses the old nature, but we reply with the new one, and Jesus has truly freed us from the penalty and the power of sin. And we now have a Genesis life where instead of walking away from God, by the power of God's Spirit within us, we walk towards him. And just as much as we were conscious of the power and the influence of the first Adam in our lives, and who is not conscious of that? Temptation, sin. We know that very powerfully. But now we are also, because we are in Christ, we are united to him. We now can experience the power and the influence of the second Adam, that's Jesus, and his influence in our lives. That's great news, I think, for us. Larry Christensen gives a little example in one of his books where he says, it's a bit like having a new landlord come who has taken control of the whole block of flats that you live in. The old landlord may turn up, he may knock the door and try to scare you into giving your money to him. But the new landlord is the one to whom you owe everything. Jesus is the new landlord. By his Spirit, he's come to live with you, not actually just to give you something. He lives with you and within you. And we have his power to turn and say to Satan, you have no right here. We need to say that. You have no authority here. You have no place in my life anymore. I belong to another. So let these thoughts help you a little bit at the start of that getting into the room of Romans 6. And pray that God will continue to give you insights. And then tomorrow we'll go into Romans 7, another room. But God will help us.